cars in this film are ridiculous. They're absolutely ridiculous.
The sound of these engines.
Whew. It's like an aircraft kicking into life.
I mean, the noise, the...
The machines are just complete masterpieces.
Mad Max was always about cars. The cars were a metaphor for power. And the one thing that George was very keen on and understood, I think, is that in a world where there's next to nothing, what little there is left needs to be loved.
Just because it's the wasteland, it doesn't mean that people can't make beautiful things.
Based on the story and the characters in the story, I was able to feed in suggestions as to what particular vehicles, like the 59 Cadillac body or the 32 Deuce Coupe for Knux's vehicle. And these vehicles were then worked on by the mechanics to end up with what you see on screen.
The vehicles did evolve from early boarding. The practicalities of building these vehicles necessitates rethinking those designs, but you do see the core of every single idea was there from the very beginning.
This looks fantastic. I know it's a lot of work. Yep, there's a lot of love, and it's metal, it's tough.
All the vehicles were real. So when you see a vehicle that's got a V12 motor in it, it's got a V12 motor in it. They were full working, enormous off-road monsters.
Vehicles are almost like an extension of the wardrobe of the characters.
The original Mad Max car, 1972, 73, XB Ford Coupe with the Scott hat and blower, known and loved throughout the world, or at least by those petrol heads in the Mad Max cult.
The V8 Interceptor stayed with Max for three of the movies, and in the old westerns, each cowboy had his favourite horse. I think Roy Rogers had Trigger. Well, I think Max has his Interceptor.
Halfway through the film, Max realises he's being attacked by another super-blown nitrous vehicle. Not only is it his car, but it's been turned into an off-road vehicle. Tyres upgraded, rear end lifted, more clearance. It becomes a Citadel Caltrop car. Caltrops are these metallic objects that can be chain dropped that basically take the tyres out of other vehicles. The gunning crew on here, obviously you can see we have a 6-barrel compressed air gun that fires. What was perspex covers for the lamps is now razor wire, as you would expect in the future. And of course, we added the screaming skull, the main image for our film. So it's really Max discovering, ironically, that he has to destroy his own car to survive.
That's mine.
That's your engine!
I remember the first time that I went to the set to look at the cars. I thought there'd be a few. I thought maybe, you know, there'd be maybe 20, maybe 25 creepy, weird cars. And I got there and they had an unbelievable array of vehicles and way beyond anything that I expected.
Eventually, you're going past war rigs, Chevrolets and V-dubs and Mercedes. The enormity of it was completely operatic.
every hero, there's a villain. For every XB interceptor, there's the Giga Horse. In a world where there's barely one of anything, to show you had power, he's the man who's got two of everything.
It's the king's vehicle, so it had to be quite spectacular, and that's why the 59 Cadillac, which I've always thought represented authority and status.
Because this is a movie on the run, the Giga Horse is virtually his throne.
You sit there and you pump that with your right foot, and everybody else for miles around knows who you are.
A pair of 1959 Cadillac Coupe de Villes.
Just the two colours are just great. I think he'd have all this polished. Someone would sit here for hours licking it.
Yeah, I'm feeling that'll be me. My tongue's rusty. This is a pair of 502 big block motors. We're actually supercharging the pair. We have had it up to 125 k's. Double tyres at the back, obviously to give us that rakish angle of looking like you're moving even when you're parked. These are actually super industrial tractor wheels that we've doubled up. We had to make our own interior rims and hubs. The exhausts we doubled up, two on either side. These are handmade. Beaten into it is the Immortan symbol, the screaming skull. George's original fight required that we had a harpoon and a flamethrower. So in a world where there's very little timber left, we thought we'd go with the timber finish. We've laid out the detailing of the Immortan's brand and also reworked the base of the Cadillac rear bumpers so that it looks like the lower jaw of the Immortan's screaming skull.
It's two V8 engines locked together into one shaft. What more can I say?
This is the Bigfoot, our monster truck that belongs to Rictus Erectus. His character basically needs to be reflected in the vehicle. Outsized, steroidal.
Rictus is 7 foot tall and a man-child.
We needed a single gunning position for Rictus to make him the most important gunner in the universe. We've added an extra gun at the back, a handmade 50 caliber machine gun.
It was a massive truck, full of armed to the teeth.
We were fortunate enough to find a Dodge Fargo, 1940s tray-top truck. This particular one is a petrol-driven monster truck, so it's basically a 572 block, turbo 400 transmission. Top speed, it's good for 120. One of the great joys of the Bigfoot is the size of the tyres, over 5.5 feet high, and basically we're putting them through hell. So this is the excavator, the mother of all the buzzards. Their MO is to attack, to drag down, to destroy and then to hack. Take away as many pieces as possible and build yet some more scary spikes to go off the outside of you. This is her double-bladed buzzsaw with which she attacks the war rig and attempts to decapitate Furiosa. This one meets a fiery and explosive death at the hands of both the war rig and Nux and Slit. Every armada has a little boy on a fife and drum. We have a large armada after the apocalypse, so we have a very large boy on a fife and a drum. Enter the Doof Wagon.
There's six drummers on the back beating these huge drums. Someone's hanging from straps on the front of a giant tank playing music that thumps out across the desert. I just think that's the coolest thing.
George had always seen a crazy machine with speakers all over it that a guitarist would stand atop and play his wild tunes whilst everyone was chasing after these characters through the desert.
If you've got a great armada of vehicles, all with big loud engines, no one's going to hear a bugle or a bagpipe. So we went for the flamethrower guitar, and then you needed massive speakers.
...64 speakers on what was originally an eight-wheel drive rocket launching truck. This is a MAN 8x8 air conditioning ducting that makes the drum resonators on either side. Our lead, Coma the Doof Warrior. This stage is another FJ Holden base and body. Fortunately, he's armed. This is also a flamethrower, used in a battle against Max himself. This lovely beast is the People Eater. It's a fuel truck and is driven and belongs to Gastown. He's basically the embodiment of the industrial military corporate universe. The front is a limousine, extended, widened Mercedes limousine on a Kaiser six-wheel drive American ex-military truck. It's pulling double tankers, and those tankers are working as a horizontal cracking station. They're actually making fuel as they drive along. This tanker is set up so that the war boys on the back can actually refuel the moving vehicles. There was a requirement to try to give him a bit more bling, and so we started to build, and we ended up with this wall of bling. Welcome to the interior of the People Eater's limousine. He has a lovely handmade steering wheel of skulls, and they said horsehair, but I haven't seen any horses in the apocalypse, but there are a few grey-haired women now walking bald. The transmission operator is pistol grip. Our rear basically has the many ledgers of which he keeps count of loss of war boys, loss of blood, loss of fuel, loss of everything. This is the Peacemaker. It's a fully handmade treaded tank vehicle. So the bullet farmer is rich in armaments and weaponry, hence the detailing is almost all 12-gauge shotguns. The exterior is actually a couple of Valiant Chargers, and then rework some of the panelling with pieces off a Cessna. So basically it's an aircraft Valiant muscle car all mounted on the world's fastest tank.
I get to drive up one of the V8 hot rods. Just a mean looking little car with upturned exhaust pipes.
Nux's car, 32 Chev Coupe, which is a fairly common hot rod project for people around the universe. It's a real V8, supercharged, turbocharged, blown, nitrous injected. We've had to give it ground clearance, more lift, heavier off-road tyres, a hybrid of sorts from your basic hot rod kit car down to your off-road death machine.
I knew from reading the script that there was a war rig in there, so I knew that there was going to be a big tanker, but the tanker itself was about twice the size of what I expected. Just completely otherworldly, and you're dwarfed under this giant vehicle, and you think, you know, how could it get any crazier than that?
The war rig, heart and soul of our film. It's both truck, transportation, hot rod, tank, warrior, and for George Chappell.
The war rig is, after the human characters, the next most important character.
It's the stage in which the most intimate drama in the most extravagant exteriors takes place.
In its own way, it's a beast.
Very early on, he told me that the overall look of the vehicle should be animalistic. That's why it has this big hump in the middle, as if it's some sort of beast in the sand.
Peter Pound in particular, he's got a very strong sense of machinery. He drew it, he worked on it, made a beautiful model.
This is a 1/10 scale model of the war rig, which was basically constructed as a guide as to what our final design should look like.
Well, I think they fire out of here. This is a little weaponry place. It just needs to be something in there. It just feels like, yeah, there's a temptation to cut it off there, but we need that extra bit.
Yeah.
I love it, Colin. I love all this.
The most optimal vehicle to actually get through the entire film was a Tatra, which is a Czechoslovakian off-road truck, originally military. The rear of it is a 1947 through 48 Chev Fleetmaster that's been cut down the centre and widened. And then we tried to make the rest of the tanker as strong for bashing, battering, climbing, clambering and setting fire to. Three complete war rigs, which are not different in any way. If one of them's driving 200 kilometres through absolute total emptiness and we need the other one back for shooting the actors, hence it was obvious we needed at least three complete units. And we've built a hydraulic cow catcher to work as both the front guards and to give us a little up and down action. Steel plate and panels decorated with the screaming skull. Basically, this is doing transport and travel runs, so it needs to be highly defensible. Hence the RSJs, the spikes, and the jagged steel hub rims to stop you being able to slash the tyres. Welcome to the interior. Obviously, we have our own favourite pieces. Mine is the accelerator, which George wanted to have a lock on so that basically it could be pushed into a high-speed drive and locked off. That kicks down, locks forward, and locks the vehicle into full thrust.
Scale and scope of the vehicles, I've never had an opportunity to have so many toys to play with before.
The vehicles, they almost deserve their own titles at the end of the film.
I cannot fathom how long it must have taken to create these things because it's just so intricate, it scares me.